Life is good. Shalom, everyone. Welcome to Wednesday night. Tonight is Wednesday. I've been thinking for the last few days because a couple of people have already talked with me about it. And I want to hopefully not take a long time, but I want to share with you some my understanding of the solar eclipse that's coming on the 8th of April. And I've been looking at different sites, trying to understand where everybody's coming from. But I want to start by going back to the book of Genesis, and I want you to listen to me because you don't have to turn there. But I'm going to do the first chapter, verses 14 and 15. Begins by saying, "Let there be luminaries in the firmament of the heavens to separate between the day and the night, and they shall serve as signs." Now, the idea of signs has multiple meanings. Rashi said that the word signs here means eclipses. Others simply said it means oat or letters. So it's talking about letters in the sky and for the festivals and for the days and for the years. So it designates or tells us about time. And they shall serve as luminaries in. Made into two great luminaries, a greater luminary to dominate the day and the lesser to dominate the evening. So we understand a lot of things, or hopefully we understand a lot of things. First off, the first question that the Jew will ask, he says, "How's come it always starts with night and then goes to day? Why doesn't it start with day and go to night?" Good question. There was a Solomon, King Solomon, in Ecclesiastes, Koheleth. In the second chapter, the 14th verse begins by saying, "I have seen the advantage of light from the darkness." Darkness isn't night. Darkness has light to it. It is concealed light. In fact, the Jew will call it zimzum. In fact, it conceals something. So the night conceals lots of things. Normally, we think of the night concealing theft, thievery, things that are evil, but it also, there are other things that are there. One of the things, as Rashi would say, are the eclipses. April 8th will be the third eclipse that has passed over the United States in the last 3 years, or actually 4 years. But the interesting thing about these eclipses, the last two, the one that just happened a year ago and the one that's coming up, crosses over in an area in the middle of the United States. It starts out over the Pacific Ocean, goes through Mexico City, up through Eagle Pass, Texas. I don't know if you know where Eagle Pass is, but you've probably seen it on your television set. From Eagle Pass, Texas, it continues up north and actually, the place in the where I'm going to go with my wife and my granddaughter, or with my daughter and my grandsons, will be up to a place that's in Bell County, which is halfway between Waco and Austin, that area where they're expected to have 3 minutes of total eclipse, and then it'll pass on. But it goes on up through there, all the way through Israel, or through Missouri, up through Canada, goes through Buffalo, New York, Toronto, Canada, out to the Montreal, and then out into the ocean, and then it's done. Now, a lot of people are making the comment that it talks about Israel. Well, Israel does has something to do with it. Actually, Israel has nothing to do with it. You see, the last solar eclipse that happened in Israel happened in 969 AD. The next one that's supposed to happen over Israel is 2215. As you can see, there's a lot of time in between. Israel's not in a position where an eclipse will happen. Now, a lunar eclipse will occur there, but for a solar eclipse, it's not the way it works. It has traditional paths that it goes through. Now, when it talks about lesser and greater, understand that the sun is 400 times greater in size than the moon. And yet we can get a total eclipse when the moon passes completely between the Earth and the sun. So imagine how the distancing is. It's precise. And it doesn't happen every month, and it doesn't happen every year. It happens when the lines of the ecliptical path that the moon travels crosses over and we can see it. Now, sometimes it doesn't occur here in the United States. It occurs in other places in the world. But the idea is the fact that it's an interesting thought. Also interesting, April 8th happens to be the beginning, the evening of the 8th will actually begin Nisan 1, or the first of the month of redemption. It's also on that particular day, back in the days, when a king in Israel was officially crowned. In other words, he could have started the job in Adar or Elul or any of the other months, but it does not officially start until the first of Nisan. That's when he is officially considered to be the king. So you have a situation. We oftentimes associate with an eclipse with tragic events. And that's not an uncommon thought. In fact, the Jews will even talk about it that way. But again, nothing of an eclipse is going to pass over Israel. So if there's a tragic event, the event would happen in the United States, because that's the major path. In fact, if you were to go to Cairo, Illinois, which is on the very southern tip of Illinois, right across the bridge, you'll end up in Missouri. Right at that point, that is the center where two of the last two eclipses will actually pass through that same area. Interesting thing, the area is called Little Egypt, because there are so many cities in that area that are actually named after Egyptian events. So, is something going to happen here in the United States because of the coincidences of this happening? Oh, by the way, at the same time, if you're lucky during the eclipse, you can actually see a comet passing by. The comet's called the Devil's Comet. And the Devil's Comet is a green comet that comes by once every 470 years. They keep track of it over and over again. Its elliptical path is going to bring it back here again 470 years from now. But as it passes by, you'll see the green ball. And at the end, it has what's called horns, twin horns that stick up the backside. And that's why it's called the Devil's Comet. Also, in the month of March, in next year, we're going to have a lunar eclipse that's going to be called the Blood Moon. It'll be a extremely bright in the United States. So, is something happening here in the United States that we have to keep thinking about? Oh, by the way, some nights, if you go out tonight or other nights, most of us are having what we would call spring weather. Lots of pollen, driving me absolutely crazy. Well, if you look up in the night sky, you might see halos around the moon. I just wanted to let you know that those halos are actually, well, they're not something mysterious. They're actually pollen that's caught in the air and illuminates through. And so what you're seeing is a halo around the moon. We also, at this point in time, and I don't know if you ever, sound like I'm an astronomer, but just by science, I love to read science and look at articles on science. Also, at the same point in time, we are now having, well, we're at the end of an 11-year cycle in the sun. And at the end of a cycle, you have a great number of flares. If you were to go to the northern country, further north than Indiana, you would find that you're also going to see the northern lights, because they're going to be extremely bright for the next several months. as the sun continues to throw off great amounts of radiation, great amounts of heat. If you were able to look at the sun, and you can go to some websites and they will show you the sun, and they will show you the storms that are on the sun, and you'll find that the storms usually run east and west. Well, there's one series of storms that run north and south. Something that's unusual, something that the scientists keep track of. Now, I don't know what all of that means, but I understand the fact that we're making it, many Bible scholars are making it into a prophetic event. It may be, but I'm not sure it affects Israel. I think the prophetic event, if there is such, will affect the United States. Because of all of the influx of immigrants with no way of telling what affiliation they belong to, the United States may be looking at a series of problems that are coming up that'll be very horrendous in the near future. But that's my take on what's going on. On also, when there's an eclipse out, the Jews will not have a blessing for it. They bless lots of things, but they never bless an eclipse. And the question is, why don't they bless an eclipse? They say it's because it has a negative connotation. The sun speaks of divine revelation. Hiding the sun speaks of a secret that's being passed to us. Now, some of us are going to study harder and harder trying to find out what that secret is, like me. But it's rather interesting. So we've had multiple, actually, since 2017, 2023, 2024, we have had three major Earth solar eclipses crossing the United States, an unusual number. Some people have looked up and they said, well, if we draw out those paths, we create the letter A. And they say, well, A stands for the letter Tav, which is the end, because it looks like a Hebrew, old calligraphy. It doesn't. A stands for A, but it looks more like an alpha, not a Tav. So I just wanted to give you my opinion at this point in time, that you and I, eclipse is supposed to remind us of light. It's supposed to remind us of how intense light is. And you and I are not supposed to look at the sun at all. And to look at the sun, well, you wear the special glasses. We can't look at the glow of the Mashiach right now. He's around, but his light is hidden. You and I, in order to see his light coming, will have to put on special glasses. We'll need to put on the Torah. We'll need to put on the mitzvot. Those will protect us from the blinding light. The sages taught, and I want to read a couple of paragraphs from a note that I found. Why in Judaism does the night precede the day on the calendar? They reply, because darkness must be allowed or must be followed by light. In other words, unlike light, darkness is not an end in itself. What is the purpose of darkness? It's meant to become incorporated and transformed into light. So too, life experiences that we call dark and may even induce despair have an aim of bringing us to a higher place. This is the deeper meaning of, and the living shall take heart. Rabbi Nachman of Breslov explains that this is the reason why we close our eyes when we say the Shema. When we focus on oneness of God, we are shutting our eyes to the barriers of this oneness, where ultimately everything has a deeper meaning. It also relates to the kissing of the tzitzit, the blue thread that's found, the tekelik, which is also related to the word tiklit, which means purpose. We may not be able to comprehend why bad things happen, but our faith can connect us to the light in the ways that are more profound than before the negative event. Just some thoughts. Open your Bibles back up, and we're going to the book of Ezekiel, and we're going to chapter 39. Now, last week I spent time talking to you about what they told us would be the first battle of Gog, and now we're going to be looking at the second battle. Now, the Hafiz Haim and other rabbis have said that the first battle was World War I. It may have been. I just can't see the secrets in it. I tried to find his writings to see if I could find that, but I haven't even found those. Chapter 39 is supposed to relate to the second battle that's going to actually occur. So in chapter 39, if you will, we're going to look at the whole chapter. It's only at 24 verses, so it's not going to take as long as it did last night. Now, son of man, prophesy against Gog. Say, thus says the Lord Hashem Elohim, behold, I am against you, Gog, the prince, or word Nasi, the leader, who's Rosh, of Meshach and Tubal. And again, we don't know really where Meshach and Tubal are. The best guesses we have put them in the Ukraine or Russia, somewhere north. That's the best we have to understand. Some say they were the Scythians, some say they were other groups of people, but that's the best we have at this point. Now it says that God said, I will lead you astray and seduce you. I will cause you to ascend from the uttermost north, which is why we say it's Ukraine or Russia, from the uppermost north and bring you upon the mountains from your right hand, or and cast you down. Try it again. I will strike your bow from your left hand and cast down your arrows from your right hand. You will fall upon the mountains of Israel, you and all your cohorts and the people who are with you. And I will give you to the bird of prey. And I will also to every winged bird and to the beasts of the field as food. Scavengers will be plentiful. They better be, because the number that the Jews have identified for being in this Gog's army is well over 4 million. It's going to take a lot of birds. It's going to take a lot of scavenger animals in order to take care of, even partially taking care of what's going on. Now notice it says that God will lead him astray. God will entice Gog to come. Now, some will tell you that this enticement is the second time. But if it is, then this Gog is not very smart, or Gog is another having the title of being Rosh. And so as we go through this story, then we're talking about somebody who is being seduced into going to Israel. And notice he's coming from the uttermost north, so we would assume that he's going to be traveling north and south, and he would end up going through either Lebanon or Syria, or maybe even down through Jordan. Now, the easiest path would be to come down along the Mediterranean through Lebanon, because that's where they have what's called the Via Mara, the way of the sea. The second path will take you inland through Syria and down. But again, it will lead you over to the coastline. Now, if you come down through Jordan, you're going to follow what's called the King's Highway. And in following the King's Highway, you're going to go directly south through Jordan, down through Amman, and that direction. Now, there are several places that you could cross, so whatever one you choose brings you into the land. But he's going to bring them down, and not only is he going to bring them down, but he's going to knock their weapons right out of their hands once they get there. Now, it doesn't say how he's going to do it. The Midrash writings on this section tell us that he is going to do it because of the fact that he will cause earthquakes, hailstorms, all the natural elements that are going to cause man to become feared or fearful at this point in time. Notice he doesn't say that the army of Israel is going to be the sole victor in this battle. It is God that is going to take the victory, not man. Because you see, this is God's war. He has ordained this war to happen if, and I always have to use the word if. You see, nothing negative, no negative prophecy has to be fulfilled. If you learn it from nothing else, we learn it from the story of Jonah and the Ninevites. Remember, God asked Jonah to go to Nineveh, and there he was supposed to tell them they had 40 days to repent. Now, he didn't want to go, and remember, out in the middle of the ocean, or in the middle of the Mediterranean, God sent a fish to pick him up and deliver him to the shoreline of Nineveh, which was not exactly close. He had to go down through the Red Sea. He had to come back up out of the Red Sea into the Persian Gulf and up the Euphrates River about 60 miles and then deposit him on the shore. Nothing miraculous about that, is there? Not only that, he did it faster than any boat that goes on that water from the Persian Gulf all the way through the Suez Canal. So he brought him there. Jonah got out, was given out, taken out of the fish. Now, I like the way Chuck Swindoll used to say it. He said the fish that ate him. Well, again, how big would that fish have had to have been? And how big would his gullet have been in order to swallow him? Now, there's another story that goes along with it, and that's the story of what happens when we die. That's a whole nother story. But Jonah came out of the fish covered in slime, mucus, because that's how a fish digests its food. So some predict that he probably had less hair. He probably had skin problems, lots of things. But whatever it was, the king saw it, and the king decided we need to repent. And so over the next 40 days, they went through a process of fasting and praying and sackcloth and ashes and all the things that we would normally think of when one repents. After it was said and done, nothing happened. God relented. It'll be 200 years later that Nahum will come by and he will prophesy the same thing, and only this time the prophecy will work. And why will it work? Because the Ninevites do not repent. So there's no reason that we have to have an Ezekiel 38 and 39. That's the choice that Israel will have to make. Because you see, this is to bring Israel and the world. But Israel is the chief player in this, because that's God's chosen. They have to come back to God. Lots of things are driving people to Israel today. In fact, there's a lot of Jews that are in New York and Miami and other places trying to encourage the Jews to come home, because they say the United States is not what it used to be. We see the Palestinian uprising within the United States does not make for a safe climate for a Jew. We read about or heard about the stories of the college students who find themselves locked in their dorm rooms because they are afraid to go out into the yard because of the Palestinian influence. All of those things are making it harder, causing more Jews to think about going home. When I was with Larry Borntrager and Tony and Glenda, we stayed in a yeshuv called Mitzvah Yeriko. Now, while we were at Mitzvah Yeriko, one of the things that I began to notice there when we started talking with the people was that most of them came from the United States. They were not natives to there. They hadn't grown up there. They were transplants that had left in the last 15 to 20 years. Well, by now it'd be 25 to 30 years. But they were all moving there because they understood what was going on and they heard the call from God to come home. Maybe this is going to be another large call to go home. Remember when the Berlin Wall fell? Remember what happened in Russia? The mass exodus. Hundreds of thousands of Jews living in Russia left. Also from the south, down where the Ethiopia, the Falashi or the Black Jew came home. Over time, things have happened. Soon you're going to see on the NETIV, I did a series on Jeremiah 50 and 51, which deals with Iraq, Saddam Hussein. But the bottom line of it is, after that war, you will find that many Jews were leaving Iraq and moving. Most went to Israel, but there were those that came to the United States. There is a great deal of migration. And you can see that here in the United States now because of the millions that have already come in. In fact, what was it? There's more people have crossed into the United States illegally in the last 3 years than there are people in 23 of the United States states. Imagine that number. As we go through this, one of the things that was going to happen and one of the things that has been predicted, and I think it's going to be true, is the fact that one of the things that's going to be in the last days will be the numbers of people that will migrate, almost like animals, searching for food, searching for peace. Happens everywhere. Remember when Syria was going through its problems with Hafez al-Assad and the Russians, and they were tear gassing. People were fleeing. Where did they go? Well, they ended up going through Turkey and they're in Europe. In another 10 years, there will be more Arabs living in Sweden than there will be Swedes. Imagine the migration patterns that are going on. Imagine what's going to happen when God begins to truly call his people home. Well, God is, if he continues the battle that we're talking about here in 39, it will be he who will actually be at war. Now, they will come from lots of directions, from the north. And it goes on to say in verse number 6, I will dispatch a fire against Magog and against those who dwell confidently in the islands, and they will know that I am Hashem. I will make my holy name known among my people Israel, and I will not desecrate my holy name any longer. Then the nations will know that I am Hashem, the Holy One in Israel. Should Israel not repent and we have this war, it will become very obvious to the world that it wasn't Israel that defeated them. It was God. And that's what it's attempting to prove here. Behold, it is coming and it will happen. The word of Hashem, Lord Elohim, that is the day on which I have spoken. Now, verse 9 goes on to say, then the inhabitants of the cities of Israel will go out and kindle fires and fuel them with their weaponry. Shield and buckler, with bow and with arrows, with mace and with spears, and they shall fuel fires with them for 7 years. So imagine all of the material. Now, a modern army doesn't spend a lot of time using wood. But I want you to understand the idea of melting down the iron, using it for something else. Eventually, remember Isaiah says they're going to put down their bows and their hooks and they will pick up farm tools instead. That same idea holds true here. 7 years to destroy the metal. In other words, clean up the land. 7 years. Quite an industry that's going to happen for that to happen. Verse 10, they will not carry wood from the field and they will not cut it from the forest, for they will fuel fires with the weaponry, the butts of the guns, all of the different places, different ways of doing things. And they will plunder those who have had plundered them and despoil those who have despoiled them. The word of the Lord Hashem Elohim, the God of the legions of armies. Imagine what's going to happen. Now notice verse 11, because now we've talked about the fact that it's going to take 7 years to burn all of this. One particular section is really going to be involved in this process. It begins by saying, and it shall be on that day that I will assign Gog a burial site there in Israel. It'll be the Valley of the Passersby. Now, some say that this is actually should have read the Valley of Passengers, which is what I talked with you about last time, where I said that if you were to go to Ein Gedi and look straight across the Dead Sea, you will find that there's this pass that comes down from just behind Amman, Jordan, down to the Dead Sea area. That's where some people say that they're coming from. This simply says the Valley of the Passersby, east of the sea. Well, it will block the passerby, and there they will bury Gog and all his multitude, and call it the Valley of Hemon Gog, Gog's multitude. If we're understanding correctly, I should say, if they're understanding correctly, because they're telling me, we're talking about the land that is going to be on the east side of the Sea of Galilee, the east side of what eventually is going, well, we'll talk about that in a little bit. It's on the east side of the Sea of Galilee. That whole area will be the area where it is. And again, that is open country. Originally, for the longest time, that was an area of the great fruit harvests. A lot of fruit and gardens were grown there. In fact, they supplied much of the fruit that's eaten in Europe. Israel is a great supplier of food for the Europeans. They may wish that they could do away with that, but they can't. They depend on Israel for their food. Now, this whole area has become a tourist attraction. What was it, in the 70s or 80s, they found the Jesus boat. I don't know if you remember the Jesus boat. It was the Sea of Galilee actually was drying up. And as it dried up, they found a boat with the same description as what was live or used during the days of Jesus. And in fact, that's why it got the name the Jesus boat. It was taken out of the sea, and that whole area then became a tourist attraction. Lots of tour boats going out onto the Sea of Galilee. It's become quite the place. And so many tours will actually go up through that area and stop. Well, he goes on to say in verse 12, the house of Israel will bury them in order to cleanse the land for 7 months. How many people are we talking about that it's going to take them 7 months to bury them all? How many people would it take? All the people of the land will bury, and it will bring them renown on the day that I manifest my glory, the word of the Lord Hashem Elohim. Again, God is expressing the fact that he is the one who will fight. He is the one. Now, the third battle, remember, goes all the way to Jerusalem, so he does not stop them. He allows them to continue. Understanding is the fact that Israel didn't get the point. Israel itself needed to change. And so the third time, Gog will reach into the city of Jerusalem itself. Now all the people of the land will bury, and I will bring them renown. All the people, not some of the people, all the people will be spending their time burying the dead. How many could that be? He goes on to say in verse 14, they will designate permanent officials to pass through the land, burying together with the passerby those that remain upon the open field to cleanse the land. So even after 7 months of burying all the dead, there will still be bones that they will find that were not buried. And there will be an official group that will go around collecting those bones and bringing them back for burial. Understand that the land can't be cleansed as long as there is death in the land. And the order to way to get rid of the death in the land was to eliminate the bodies themselves. So there's no way to cleanse the land. All we are doing is taking what's above the surface and putting it into the ground. So after 7 months, they will begin to search. The passerby will traverse the land, and when they see a human bone, they will build a marker near it until the buriers bury it in the valley. Now they have a name for this place, the cemetery, or actually it's not a cemetery, it's a valley. The valley of Hamon Gog. That's the valley that they're going to be burying them in. Imagine how many it is. Not only that, we'll read later on that they not only had this valley where they had the cemetery, they're actually going to build a city in there to take care of all of the waste of this. If you had sinful products that you wanted to get rid of, you would go to this city and deposit it there to be taken out and buried with all of the soldiers of Gog. There will also be a city, this is it, called Hamana or Hamona, which means her multitude. So there's going to be a city. Thus, they will cleanse the land. Hold it. Thus, they will cleanse the land. Almost. You see, the cleansing cannot be completed without the ashes of the red heifer. The ashes of the red heifer are the ashes that are sprinkled along with water upon whatever. That is the cleansing process. Those ashes will be used to cleanse the rivers, to cleanse the ponds, to cleanse the streams, to cleanse any body of water. So before Gog 2 happens, we're going to have to find the ashes of the red heifer. But if that's true, then we can't have World War II being Gog 2. That was part of my problems with dealing with this whole chapter. Now, verse 17 goes on to say, now you, son of man, thus says the Lord Hashem Elohim, say to every winged bird and every beast of the field, assemble and come, gather together from all around for my feast, and that I slaughter for you, a great feast upon the mountains of Israel. Eat flesh and drink blood. Eat the flesh of warriors and drink the blood of the earth's princes. All of them, like rams, lambs, and he-goats, bulls and fatlings of Bashan, eat fat to satiate and to drink blood to intoxication from my feast that I have slaughtered for you. Sate yourselves at my table with horse and rider, warrior and every man of war. The word of the Lord Hashem Elohim. Imagine how many animals, how many scavengers will that take if it's going to take them 7 months just to bury the dead? imagine what it will look like after that battle. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Patton. Patton is one of those movies, George C. Scott. And George C. Scott plays it to the point where he almost becomes insane being Patton. But Patton himself was a little bit odd because Patton believed in reincarnation. He had believed that he had already been to many of the places that he was warring in, that he had been in Attila the Hun, that he had been these generals. But the beginning of the story shows him driving with his entourage through an area where there had been a battle. And now there is this battle going on. You see these people scattering around, stripping the bodies naked, birds, animals raw, eating flesh. Gives you the idea in a small area what it would look like. I can't imagine an entire valley. I can't imagine an open field country. If you were to go to Illinois, you could go from one town to another in the middle of Illinois and you never see a hill. All flat. That's what it's going to look like on the west, on the east side of the Sea of Galilee. Open, flat country. Bowl shaped so you can see all that were there. Verse 21. I will manifest my glory among the nations, and all the nations will see my judgments that I have executed, my hand that I have placed upon them. Then the house of Israel will know that I am Hashem, their God, from that day and onwards. Now they will know. Question, does that mean they believe? They know he's God, but do they believe? And if they believe, are they willing to change? Are they willing to repent? Because if they're not, then Zechariah 12, 13, and 14 are in their future. Now, verse 23 begins, then the nations will know that because of their iniquity. Notice, the nations will know. Now, it was aimed at the Jews. They are going to understand, but the nations are also going to understand who is God. One of the things that we have for a problem in our world today is Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. Which one's right? He goes on to say in this story, let's see, the nations will know that because of their iniquity, the house of Israel was exiled. Because they betrayed me, and I hid my countenance from them, and I delivered them into the hands of their enemies, and they fell by the sword, all of them. I dealt with them in accordance with their contamination and their sins, and I hid my countenance from them. I hid my countenance from them. In the dark, God has been concealed. But the darkness isn't dark because it's really light, according to Solomon. Now, therefore, thus says the Lord Hashem Elohim, now I will bring back the captivity of Jacob and show mercy for the entire house of Israel and be zealous for my holy name. This battle will begin to bring his people home. Not that they hadn't started before, but it will be the concluding idea. We know that in World War II, the Holocaust drove many people home. People living in Europe, especially Poland and Hungary, because that was a large population of Jews. Entire cities of Jews were actually exterminated. Those that were able to hide had to hide until the end of the war before they could find a way to get to Israel or to the United States or to a safe place. There therefore says Hashem, Lord Elohim, verse 25, now I will bring back the captivity of Jacob and show mercy to the entire house of Israel and the zealous of my holy name. They will bear their shame and all their betrayal that they committed against me when they dwell securely upon their soil, and none will make them afraid. None will make them afraid when I return them from the peoples and gather them in from the lands of their enemies, and I become sanctified through them in the eyes of the many nations. So the conclusion of this whole thing will be when they bring them all home. And in bringing them all home, we will recognize God as a nation, not as an individual, but as a nation. The nations will recognize God. He goes on to say in this particular story, verse 28, then they will know that I am Hashem, their God, for I have exiled them to the nations, and I will bring them to their land, and I will leave them, or I will not leave them, of any of them there. No Jew will be left behind. Last verse. Then I will not hide my countenance from them again, for I will pour out my spirit upon the house of Israel. The word of the Lord, Hashem Elohim. I will pour out my spirit upon the house of Israel. Joel talks about this. Ezekiel will talk about it. You see, Ezekiel 40 through 48 deal with these chapters, deal with this understanding, deal with the new temple, deal with the waters, deal with all of these things. They will know, and my countenance will be with them always. The end. Well, not really.